Welcome to Genesis Volatility's educational series. Today we'll talk about volatility indexes. More specifically, we'll talk about Deribit's DVOL index, which is a Bitcoin implied volatility index, and we'll make comparisons to the VIX index, which is an SPX or S&P 500 implied volatility index. With the introduction of options, investors for the very first time could bet on volatility. They could see where options were pricing implied volatility, and if they disagreed with that, they could go ahead in the underlying market and dynamically hedge the realized volatility of the underlying asset and capture the differential between implied volatility and realized volatility. In theory, this works perfectly well, but in practice, not so much. There are some costs associated with practically implementing the strategy. For example, dynamically hedging has transaction costs associated with it. If you were going to hedge every little deviation in the underlying price, you'd pay so many transaction fees that the trade would be unprofitable. But if you didn't hedge enough, you would introduce variance that would deviate from the performance of the implied versus realized volatility relationship. Another deviation from theory is called path dependency. Let's explore that a little bit. The idea of path dependency states that the profitability of a volatility trade will be dependent on the path of the underlying price. For example, let's say that we think that options are too cheap. So we go ahead and buy an option, which is a cash outflow, but we hope to recoup that cost through gamma scalping or delta rebalancing. And every time we rebalance, this creates a little bit of income. So we hope that the income received from rebalancing exceeds the cost of the option. And that's how we profit from the differential between implied and realized. Let's say that we have an at-the-money option. Well, the at-the-money option has the greatest gamma. And so if we bounce around our strike and stay near the money, our gamma scalping is going to be very profitable. But let's say that the underlying moves away from our strike, and then the volatility comes in this new zone where we are far away from our strike, those gamma scalps are going to have smaller impacts. And therefore, the income generated from the gamma scalping is going to be smaller than anticipated. We could be right about the volatility. We could be right about the bouncing around effect, but wrong about the strike, which provides the greatest gamma. This is the idea of path dependency. There is path dependency to doing realized versus implied volatility spread differentials. Theta also compounds the effects of path dependency. Think about it like this. Let's say we've moved 5% away from our strike, but we still have an option that has 1 year left until expiration. While with a long-dated option, being 5% away from our strike has almost zero impact. We're basically still about at the money. But let's say there's only 1 day left until expiration. Well, an option with 1 day left till expiration that's 5% away from the strike will have something like a 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 delta, something very, very small. And the gamma effects are so minute that you might not even need to rebalance at all. So theta actually changes your delta profile, which also changes your gamma profile. So path dependency is really affected or compounded even further by theta effects. These are some of the outside forces that can impact the profitability of your volatility trading. What strikes you pick, what expirations you target, all those things will have an impact on the bottom line of your volatility trade. Volatility indexes such as the DVOL or the VIX introduced for the first time a standardized volatility metric. Instead of figuring out which strike to look at, each individual strike is incorporated in that final output. And instead of trying to decipher which expiration to look at, we have a standardized 30-day volatility metric. So we have a 30-day volatility metric that incorporates all the strikes. Let's dig into that a little bit deeper. If you're interested in looking at the math behind a DVOL index, you can find those calculations directly on Deribit's website, and you can look for yourself at all the calculations behind the DVOL index. But let me give you a broad overview of some of the concepts here. The first thing to remember here is that when we're looking at a volatility index, what we're mainly interested in is the time value of options, or the volatility of value of options. So what this means is that we need to isolate out of the money options and exclude all the in the money options. This necessitates that we know what the forward price of the underlying is. We do this by looking at the strikes that are closest to the money and using the put call parity in order to extract the forward price from the options market. Once we have that forward price extracted from the options market, we can go ahead and use that as our underlying price and exclude all the in the money options. An additional consideration is that options that are far too out of the money or are also illiquid are excluded from the index. Including them would cause the index to be skewed too heavily towards those values, so it makes sense to exclude them. Now, the second aspect is that we're targeting a 30-day constant maturity. So we do this by looking at options that have more than 30 days but are closest to 30 days, and the options that have less than 30 days but are closest to 30 days. Now, given those two series, what we do is we'll extrapolate between the two to target a 30-day constant maturity. What this means is that every minute that goes by, every day that goes by, every hour that goes by, requires slight adjustments to the rebalancing ratio of the two expiration series in order to stay at a constant 30-day maturity. The third consideration is that we're targeting a constant vega exposure. Now, what this means in practical terms is that we need to weigh options with different strike prices differently. Think about it like this. If an option is at the money, but the underlying is $10, what is the vega exposure compared to an option that's at the money, but the underlying is $1,000? There's a lot more vega exposure if the underlying is $1,000 and we're talking about an at the money option versus an at the money option of the underlying at $10. Therefore, options with lower strikes have a higher weighting to them, and options with higher strikes have a lower weighting to them. Finally, after making all these sorts of adjustments, we have a normalized volatility value, and we could build trading products on top of this index. These vehicles will allow us to trade pure volatility plays that are not affected by the costs of dynamic hedging or the impact of path dependency or theta or things like that. And this is where these indexes become very exciting. Let's jump into some of the practical considerations of trading DVOL futures or VIX futures. One of the most practical considerations to remember when you're trading volatility index futures is that it's nearly impossible to recreate the underlying portfolio of the index. Because the index is constantly changing in terms of time until expiration or the underlying is moving, you would need to constantly rebalance all your options. And this makes it so expensive to do that it's nearly impossible. What you'll notice when you're trading volatility index futures is that the futures price and the index price are nearly never the same. Only at expiration do they converge to the same price. At expiration, the futures price necessitates that it's the same price as the index price. But until then, you'll often see the future price trade at a premium to the index or at a discount to the index. Let's go ahead and look at an example with VIX futures. You can see that the VIX index is trading below 17, but the front month VIX future is trading above 18. Now, if the VIX index just stays put here until the future's expiration, the future will decay all the way down to the same price as the VIX. And so there will be a loss attributed to VIX futures buyers. On the opposite side, it's possible that the VIX index moves higher by expiration to meet the VIX future or even exceed the VIX future. That is what the VIX buyer is hoping will happen. A common theme that you'll see when trading volatility index futures is that the obvious trade has a high carry cost associated with it. So for example, it's highly unlikely that the VIX ever really goes below 10. But we've seen it go above 90 before, and above 40 before, and maybe we'll go above 35 by the end of the year. So it's very favorable for the VIX futures buyer in terms of a risk-reward ratio to be long the future. But as we see now, if the VIX just stays where it is, there's a lot of decay costs associated with being long the VIX future. And therefore, the obvious trade is expensive. The same thing is true in a high volatility environment. When the volatility index is high, we expect it to come back down at some point in the future. And the volatility index futures term structure will be backwardated, meaning that the front month volatility future will be below the index price, the second month out will be below the front month, and so on and so forth. And again, if the volatility index stays high, being short the volatility future will have decay associated to it as well, because the volatility index future will appreciate up to the index by expiration, assuming that the index stays put. These are the themes of trading volatility index futures. I hope you found this video helpful, and remember, find edge, capture alpha, and slang size.